Hi, I'm Brother Lars Jordan, pastor of the New Bethel Baptist Church located at 2729 Oak Grove Road in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. And we are here today doing the Sunday school lesson, going through the Sunday school lesson, or giving commentary on the Sunday school lesson for the February the 7th, 2016. This is the sixth lesson of this quarter, according to the Boyd's book. And the topic of the lesson today is Free at Last. And our unifying topic is Passover. And our lesson today comes from Exodus, the 12th chapter, verses 1 through 14. Now, background scriptures are Exodus, the 12th chapter, verses 1 through 14, Numbers, the 28th chapter, verses 16 through 25, and Mark, the 14th chapter, verses 12 through 26. Our lesson today, this word, Passover, it's a word that is talked about a lot, and it ties definitely into the Boyd's title of this lesson, saying free at last. Because the children of Israel had been in bondage in the land of Egypt for quite some time now. Now, we know how they got there that years ago, before this event that we're talking about today happened, many, many years, over 400 years, about 430 years is how long these children of Israel were in Egypt. They got there approximately 1877 to 1875 BC, and now they're still there. They've been there for some time. They went in on a life-saving note. It's amazing that they went in to save their life, and they're leaving as freedom to also save their lives in a sense of the slavery and the brutality of their slave situation that they were in. Something had to give. The children of Israel may have gotten comfortable there in the land of Egypt. The land of Egypt, when we talk about the land of Egypt through the word of God and concerning our relationship to Jesus Christ, we see the land of Egypt as a type of the world, a type of the picture of a believer before they came to the knowledge of Jesus Christ and his saving power in their lives. We look at Egypt as this type of the world, and the children of Israel there in Egypt now at this time have been bound down. But they got there into the world. There, Joseph being the second man in charge when they got there to the saving of their lives from the famine that they were going through when the patriarch Jacob had sent his sons to try to find means to keep them alive, some food to sustain them. And finally, when Joseph revealed himself, they brought back Jacob there, and they all were living there and were probably at first quite comfortable in the world, in Egypt, there in this situation. And now, as time went by, God had promised Abraham that his descendants would be as numerous as the stars in the sky, as the sand on the seashore, the people of faith, this Israelite nation, and even into the people of faith calling on us today. And this promise was brought down through the patriarchs to Isaac and then to Jacob. But they were also promised a land of their own. And living there in Egypt, they could not acquire the land that God had promised to give them. They were there in the world and satisfied. So over time, God allowed the heavy hand of Pharaoh to come down on the children of Israel. Now it's been about 430 years. Now it's approximately 1447 to 1445 BC, and now they've been here for some time now. The comfort level long gone. The Pharaoh that brought Joseph in and let him be the second man in charge, he's been long gone. These people marched into Egypt to the saving of their lives from the plague, and now they have been satisfied living in the type of the world situation. They came in as a family, the family of Jacob. But now God had allowed the children of Israel to rapidly reproduce. And now they had grown into a great nation. They were no longer just a family that marched in that looked like refugees when they got there. Now they were this great nation of people. But they were living under the heavy hand of Pharaoh. So God was working in through this situation. For now, the children of Israel for some time had been crying out to God for deliverance. God took his time and he raised up a deliverer. He raised the deliverer in the household of Pharaoh, sent him out to the wilderness at the age of 40. He lived in the wilderness for 40 years, learning how to mine and tend to the flocks. And now he comes back, seemingly at the age of 80, to deliver, to be the deliverer that God sends in to Egypt to bring his children out by God's great hand, working in through his person, his servant Moses, and also his brother Aaron. So now, this is where our lesson is today. They've been here in Egypt, working hard for the Pharaoh. Egypt has become this wonderful place because of all the labor of the Israelite nation now, not the family of Jacob, but the nation of Israel. Now this nation wants to be delivered, and God has sent a deliverer. Now, taking place to get them out of Egypt, it would be hard to just walk into Egypt and tell the Pharaoh, as God told Moses, to just let my people go. So God knew that his hand would have to be instrumental in bringing the children of Israel out. This was not only for Pharaoh, but it was so that the children of Israel could see the hand of God. And even the Israelite nation of the Egyptian people also, rather, to see the hand of the God of the Israelites. So God sent in the plagues. The first one was the plague of the blood. And then the plague of the frogs. Then the lice, the flies, the cattle, the boils, the hail, the locusts, the darkness that came over the land of Egypt, yet it did not affect the land of Goshen where the children of Israel were housed. The first three plagues actually bothered the children of Israel also, but after that, God kept the plagues from bothering them. But the last plague came with a stipulation. The last plague came with faith. You would have to have faith in God to deliver you from this situation, or so that you could live, or your firstborn could live through this situation. Now, all of these things would point to Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. In the 11th chapter, the Lord had sent Moses to talk to Pharaoh, as he did in all the other situations when the plagues were about to come, because this last plague would be very serious. God sent Moses, and he was talking there to Pharaoh in the fourth verse of the 11th chapter. He said, "And Moses said, thus saith the Lord, about midnight I will go out into the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sitteth upon his throne, even unto the firstborn of the handmaid servant that is behind the meal and all the firstborn of beasts. And there shall be a great cry throughout the land of Egypt, such as there was none like it, nor shall there be it anymore. But against any of the children of Israel shall not a dog move his tongue, against man or beast, that ye may know how the Lord doeth put a difference between the Egyptians and Israel. And all these that thy servant shall come down unto me and bow down themselves unto me, saying, get thee out, and all the people that follow thee, and after that I will go out. And he went out from Pharaoh in a great anger. Moses left Pharaoh after he had given him this message. And the Bible says here, he went out in a great anger. All the other plagues that came upon the children, the people of Egypt, and then the Pharaoh, and Moses never displayed this temperament before. But this time, when you have the power to do something, and now it's not just going to be frogs hopping around and laying in the bed with your water being turned to blood, but now the very lives of your people. Do you care enough about your people to listen and hearken to the voice of the Lord? But the Bible says in verse 9 of that chapter, and the Lord said unto Moses, Pharaoh shall not hearken unto you, that my wonders may be multiplied in the land of Egypt. And Moses and Aaron did all these wonders before Pharaoh, and the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart so that he would not let the children of Israel go out of his land. The final plague was going to come. How much do you care about your people? Do you care about them enough to save them from death? That is the question to every believer. Do you care enough about the people to offer Christ to them, because only the blood can save? So now our lesson starts the 12th chapter, verse 1 says, and the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, the Lord was the one that was speaking to them at this time. If you look in your Bible, your study Bible, you'll see that Lord is in all caps there, meaning that this is Yahweh or Jehovah. This is the great God of Israel. This is the person that we say in our ceremonial type prayers, Father of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Here we say is the Lord that spoke to Moses and Aaron at this time. Not just Moses, but Moses and Aaron. And in the land, while they were in the land of Egypt, he said, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Maybe not to everybody else, but to you. This will be the first month. This was Abib. Now, later on, when they were in Babylon, they found out this same month was Nisan. But here is Abib, because this is a Canaanite type name. And it was for the harvest, bringing in the first of the harvest. So this was somewhere between the latter part of March, April, to the first part of May, somewhere in that area. But here we see, and some will try to put a more definite on that. I'll just leave it there, because I don't know for sure, that just to be honest. It shall be unto you the first month of the year. God tells them that this is going to be something that you will remember. They will remember. We may not truly understand, but they will remember, because God decided to change time at this time with them, for them at this time. This will be the first month of the year to you, is what the end of the verse says there, verse 2. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel. Congregation, first time it's mentioned in the scriptures, talking about when the whole body can come together, maybe with the elders or the older people or the men of this, speaking specifically on this, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to themselves every man a lamb. Now we'll find out lamb in this particular instance can be a lamb as we know it, or a young goat also. According to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. Each house was to have a lamb. Now, God will break that down further here as we get on into this, because we'll find out that everybody can't eat up a whole lamb. So, and it has to be eaten in a certain period of time. So verse 4 says, and if the household be too little for the lamb, not the lamb too little for the household, but if the household be too little for the lamb, maybe the husband and the wife, and they don't have any children at this time, maybe it's too small, maybe their household is too small for a whole lamb. Because this lamb is a year old, which is almost pretty much full grown. Looking at this lamb, be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of souls. Take this lamb and see how many households this lamb can actually feed. If it can feed this household and another family down the street only have the husband and wife, and that family there only have the husband and wife, then we could get together in this lamb. But this lamb probably could feed maybe 20 people. So we'll see that this could be, as we look at this, this lamb could feed many families at this time, because they would have to eat all they're going to eat in this one setting. So here it says, according to the number of souls, every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. What can you eat? Just let's get this measured up and how many families we need to bring into this according to how much each person can eat of the lamb. Your lamb, verse 5 says, shall be without blemish. Now, this is the point where we know that we're speaking of a bigger lamb or a better lamb. We're talking about someone else in this situation. Now, it is very important that they understand what God is saying here. Your lamb should be without blemish. This lamb is not to be hurt in any type of way, not to be crippled or anything like that, have any defects or anything on it. It's supposed to be a male lamb of the first year. And more than likely, this first year means a year old. And a male lamb of the first year. And ye shall take it from out of the sheep. And this helps us to understand. Or from the goat. Yet it's still called a lamb, because it'll be the sacrificial lamb. And then verse 6 says, and ye shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. Now, many talk about why we're keeping this up until the 14th day of this month. Well, one of the reasons may be that they're trying to make sure that this lamb is unblemished, is this perfect specimen. It has no defects, and this gives us time to watch over and look at this lamb these few days. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. It shall kill it. Now, this is in the KJV, in the King James Version. Other versions try to expand this and help you out. But I think if you take the King James Version and use what it's saying here, it'll help you understand and look forward to that perfect, unblemished lamb that was sacrificed for us, was our substitution. So look at this. It said, shall kill it, meaning that this will be one accord, and this thing will happen here in the evening. Everyone would kill this lamb, but it would be many lambs that would be killed, but it would be for one purpose. Shall kill it, one purpose to save lives. So those would be saved that put the blood of the lamb on their doorpost. It says, shall kill it in the evening, and they shall take the blood and strike it on the two side posts and the upper doorposts of the houses wherein they shall eat it. They're going to eat the lamb. Now they took the blood, put it in a basin, as we find out if you read the rest of the chapter. They put the blood in a basin and took the hyssop bush and but more than likely had a sponge on top of it and struck the doorpost and the lintel on top of the doorpost and up between the doorpost, rather, what we call here the upper doorpost. And they did that on the building or the house where they would eat this particular lamb or goat at. Verse 8 says, they shall eat the flesh in that night. They shall eat it that night. This night when all of these things come to pass, all these things are going to happen. After the 14 days, this is the night that these things are going to happen. They took it out in the evening, probably between 3 and 6. Some say it was actually later, but now we've gotten to the point where it would be the first of the month, and more than likely the new moon would be up, and it'll be even light on into the evening, as some would interpret that and say, that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Now, specifically, God said that they shall eat the flesh that night. This very night, it is to be roasted. That this would be very important. The next verse is going to explain some of that to us. And it is to be eaten also with bread that doesn't have any leaven in it, anything to make it rise up. And the specifics in that is so that is the urgency of getting out. And that's the main part of this. And later on in the New Testament, it'll help us to understand that leaven was speaking of sin. So it wouldn't have any time for the sin to affect this bread or get into this bread. And with bitter herbs ye shall eat it. Now, that has been explained several different ways, but if you're looking at the context that we're drawing from at this time and know where the children of Israel were, what they were going through at this time, the bitterness would help them to remember, because this would become a memorial. The Passover feast would become a memorial. And they eat these bitter things to help them understand the bitter conditions that they came out of. Or generations later, even when Josiah reestablished this institution of the Passover during his kingship, they would understand that the bitterness in the herbs was to understand the bitterness that they suffered while they were there in Egypt. Some say this may be because of the bitterness of the suffering of Christ. I do agree that was a very bitter thing that Christ suffered. So if you take that to being what this means to you, I am perfectly fine with that. But I believe also that it refers to and helps them remember the bitter treatment of the children of Israel while they were there in Egypt, also helping them to want to get out of Egypt. Verse 9 says, eat not of it raw. This was to be roasted. We just saw that in verse 8. Don't eat it raw, nor sullen in all at all with water. In other words, don't put it in a boiling pot and boil it down, but roast with fire. Fire was always something that meant judgment. The judgment was about to fall down upon the people that they were about to leave, and that was the Egyptians there in Egypt. Even while they were still there, judgment was about to fall upon Egypt. His head with his legs and with the pertness thereof. This thing was to be stripped down and washed up, but still wholly together, to be put on a rack and roasted with fire, without its legs being broken, according to verse 46, and even taking us to John chapter 19, when Jesus' legs were not broke. These things were to happen so that you would get out of there and looking forward to Jesus when there was not to be a broken bone in his body. And ye shall let nothing of it remain until morning. You are supposed to eat every bit of it, or all of it that you can eat. That's why it was very imperative that you sectioned yourself off with houses that were in the like situation like you were, if the lamb was too big for just you and your little family. So now it says, let nothing be left remain until morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning ye shall burn with fire. Because this was for a sacrificial gift to the Lord, you don't keep this to the next day. If it's something left over, burn it with fire, is what the Lord says here. And thus shall ye eat it with your loins girded. In other words, dressed up. You're dressed up. You're not in your house shoes and your house coat and with your curlers in your hair. You eating this dressed up and ready to go, your shoes on your feet, your staff in your hand, not standing over by the door for when you exit the house, but your staff in your hand. So you'll be ready to go, and ye shall eat it in haste. Don't sit there and drag around with it in a leisure meal. This is to be eaten in haste. And the Lord gives a reason for that. At the end of verse 11, saying, it is the Lord's Passover. That's the most important part about this. Verse 12 says, for I will pass through. God said, I'm the one that's going to pass through. Yes, I am the one that have the power of life and death. As we found out in our last week's lesson, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. In other words, even if something dies, the Lord calls that because he is the one that can take life away. I will pass through the land of Egypt this night. God said, I will and will smite all the firstborn. Let's take the context there. I will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And look at the reason for this, land and beast. And against all the gods of Egypt, because some of them use lambs and goats and bullocks and bulls and all these type of things as idols to them, idol gods to them. So both land, man and beast would be killed this night, the firstborn of both man and beast. So against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment, God said, I am the Lord. Capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, I am the Lord. And the blood shall be to you for a token, a substitution upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, God said, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt, when I see the blood. And that takes you to a lot of different areas. God said, when I see the blood, not when I see how good you've been in your life, how much you have helped the poor, how many things you have done to try to merit my favor in your life. He said, the blood, when I see the blood, not all those things, I'm not looking at those things, the blood of the Lamb, it is the blood that'll never lose its power. This is what God is saying here. The plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. And here is the main thought verse. It says, and this day, verse 14, shall be unto you for a memorial, and ye shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generation. Ye shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever. And we're looking back to this even now. This day, you'll remember forever. This will be a memorial, and you shall keep this feast. He told these children of Israel here at this. Moses and Aaron gave them this message. This is the Passover. God said, I'll be the one to pass over when I see the blood. When you have been obedient to the blood, when you have put the blood, when we have been robed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Paul told us in 1 Corinthians 5 and 7 that for even Christ, our Passover, sacrificed for us. Father God, we thank you today for the study of your word. And Father, we pray that this word will get into our hearts and minds and simmer on us all the day long, Lord. Help us to understand that Jesus Christ is our Passover lamb, Lord, and the blood still works. Father, we do pray that you'll search our hearts, forgive us of sin. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.